call a meeting to order on September, what's the date, 12th? 2016. We have to reorganize tonight, and as chair, I'm going to turn the meeting over to our new superintendent, and welcome to your first meeting.
Thank you. Thank you. I would like to entertain nominations for school committee chair.
Are you interested?
I'm happy to defer.
Okay. I nominate Don Sprasky to be the chairman again for the 2016-2017 school year.
All for yays? Oh, I need a second.
Yeah.
Second.
Thank you. And all for yay?
Yay.
And nay? And abstain?
No. Three and oh.
Do I abstain? I don't know.
Well, you can either vote for yourself or you can abstain.
I'll vote for myself.
Okay, you got it. Okay. New chair of the Whately School Committee, I hand the meeting back to you.
All right.
Thank you.
We have a couple of appointments. We need to vote a vice chair.
I nominate Katie to be vice chair.
Okay.
That's just in case he's not here.
So you want to close nominations, all right?
Yes, close nominations.
Okay. Okay. And I'll second her nomination. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Katie, you interested in continuing at the collaborative?
Sure. I'm happy to do that.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's an appointment. I'll appoint you to that. And secretary, Bob, you want to do that? I know superintendent takes the, but we do have to have somebody on record.
Sure. I mean, I'll be more than happy to.
I'll nominate
2 minutes, but
Bob Bruce as secretary.
Oh, second.
Well, nominations are closed. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, Bob, thank you.
Yes.
And capital planning. I think the way that works, and I could be wrong, it wouldn't be the first time, but that is the superintendent who actually appoints someone to represent the superintendent, and I would be happy to do that. I've been on the Capital Improvement Committee for a number of years. So
great.
If you want me to do that, I will.
Do we need
do
to
that.
Vote on that?
I don't think so.
Okay. Not on a
point. So with that said, we're ready for minutes, I believe.
How about, do we have to worry about negotiation team, even though we're not doing yet?
No, not until we need it.
Okay.
Was there any other ones?
Frontier representative.
Ah, that's the most important one.
Yes, it is.
Sure.
If you want me to nominate you, Robert?
Okay.
I guess I appoint him. I think we do appoint you, don't
we? I think you can appoint that one.
Yeah.
Okay, so
I'll appoint Bob Howard of Frontier for the year.
Okay. Thanks.
And all three of you vote, are voting members, so you don't have to do that one.
All right. So I think we're all set. So we can go to minutes. In minutes of May 2nd, we need to rescind one vote that we took, and that was for the teachers' agreement. It was voted 3-0, and I need to abstain from that. So I'd like a vote to rescind that vote and then re-vote it.
Just on the teachers' one, right?
Yeah.
Not on the instructional assistants?
No.
I'll make a motion to rescind the minutes to include the teachers' agreement that was voted 3-0. Don's going to abstain on it.
So we're just going to need a motion to rescind the vote.
Yeah.
Just
motion to rescind the vote.
Motion to rescind the vote.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, now, as amended, we're going to vote, re-vote that. Okay, so.
So we need a motion to
motion
vote to approve to accept.
Accept. The teacher's contract.
Motion to accept the teacher's 2016-2019 teacher's contract.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Two, and I abstain.
Mm-hmm. Good. 2-0-1.
And the rest of the minutes are good.
Yeah. Pardon. So we have to make a motion. Do we have to make a motion to accept the minutes?
As corrected.
As corrected. I'll make a motion as with corrections for May 2nd.
Second.
Any further discussion? Seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Perfect. And the June minutes, June 6th.
Make a motion to accept the minutes of June 6th.
Second.
Any further discussion? Not? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Agreed enough. Okay, public comment. None. Moving on. Green Community Grant. I did skip you. Financial.
All right, so tonight I gave you a lot of paperwork. You should have two of these. One in the corner will say FY16, and that is our final report as of June 30th. And this, from this document here, I will prepare and submit the end-of-year report to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. That report is due by 9:30 and will need to be signed by the chair as well as the superintendent and the town. So I usually submit the reports and follow up with the signatures in October so that we can meet our deadline. The second one of these is our FY17, what we have spent so far in July and August. And as of July and August, the salaries have not been encumbered. They will appear on your September report, which you will receive in October. So all the salaries for the year will be encumbered. We do have 8 warrants tonight that total $54,515.43. In the warrants you have tonight, there is a school choice warrant for an invoice in the amount of $2,897.85. This invoice was submitted late by the vendor. And we, because school choice is a revolving fund, it is the only fund that we can now pay from. All other monies have been otherwise encumbered and spent. I can tell you that in the encumbrances for school choice, I encumbered about $7,000 in payroll, and only about $5,000 came through. So we can use the difference in that encumbrance to pay the majority of this bill. And there will only be a couple hundred dollars that will come out of FY17 money.
Can you explain, is there a balance in the school choice account?
Yes, so I gave you tonight two sheets stapled together. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the first one is going to tell us how we ended up in FY16.
The first page.
Second.
The first page is our FY16 actual. So if you look at FY16, the first page, you'll see that we budgeted to have $23,911 to carry forward to the next year. Yes, in mm-hmm. the first column, last line. Actually, we are only carrying over $13,288 into the new year. And that is because our revenue was down. So were our expenses. Our revenue was down $27,243, and our expenses were down $16,620. So it nets out to a difference of $10,623. So if we carry that forward into 17, I've now adjusted for 17. On the left is what we budgeted. In the middle column is what we now expect to happen in 17. So where we thought we would be almost $100,000 in the hole at the end of this year, we're now only $63,000 in the hole. And when I say in the hole, it's our philosophy of spending a year in arrears. So our cash account at the town is fine. It's just that we will be spending all of FY16's revenue plus $63,000 of the FY17 revenue that will come in this year.
And if there's no other changes, Patty, then you anticipate that that balance will be the last column?
No, the last column is the difference between what we thought we were going to be at and where we're going to be.
Okay.
So we're $34,000 better than we thought we were going to be at the beginning of this year. And again, the revenue number for 17 could change.
If more school choice kids come
Correct.
In the next...
They base the beginning estimate on our ending June.
Oh, so that could be
So it could be worse?
No. Well, it depends on, I'd have to look at our numbers to see how many sixth graders we lost versus how many kindergartners we brought in. And also, if there's any new children that will be on sped increment.
Our numbers are a little bit lower. We accepted enough school choice kids to get our numbers back to what they were, but a lot of the folks that we offered a space to didn't take it, well, went elsewhere. So I think we have 30-something school choice kids. I don't know what our projection is.
38 on the thing that went out today.
Yeah. That's right, that came out today, 38, but I think we projected higher.
Compared to like 46.
Right, and we discussed this during the budget, that we are spending more than we should. So we need to, this year, we really need to take more money onto our local budget and less money on the school choice. Mm-hmm. So when we go to budget season this year, we're going to be looking to make those changes.
I think we have to. I mean,
and one segue, if you don't mind my saying so, around getting back to the original bill that prompted part of this conversation, that's a bill from School Sprouts, our garden consultant, who has always turned her bills in right on time at the end of the school year. This year she didn't, and quite frankly, it slipped past me. I didn't think, oh, I didn't get Hope's bill, you know? Mm-hmm. I get my POs, I sign off on them. And I didn't realize that she hadn't turned in her bill, so now she just sent it to me by email literally 2 weeks ago, well after the fiscal year ended. So we're just figuring out where we need to pay that bill from. But that's an expenditure that we have tried to put in the budget previously and needed to cut back. If we can do that this year, if we can put the garden program into the budget either in part or in full, that would be one more thing that we're not counting on school choice for. And avoid this problem, hopefully, where we don't get billed on time. But she's never done it before. It was an oversight on her part, and it never occurred to me that it didn't cross my desk until she sent it. That's why we're in the situation.
So if that were in this number, it would be 15,000, whatever. It'd be 13,000 plus the bill, potentially.
Less. Well, part of it. The 13,000 will stay the same except for a couple hundred dollars, because I had accrued some payroll into that 13 that we didn't expend. So I can use those unexpended payroll monies to pay this bill. And I think the difference is like $200 or $300.
Oh, okay. So is that in the school choice, the accrued payroll?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So this number wouldn't change very much?
No. 13.
Since we're talking about school choice, on the sheet that you gave, the two sheets that you gave us,
mm-hmm.
you said cafeteria expense $36.68. Thought it was more than that. We voted more money for school choice. Oh, we did that out of the budget, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, where's this one coming from?
This was the deficit from last year. Remember that if we end up in a deficit. So this was this was FY15's cafeteria deficit.
No.
That we had to pay.
No.
No?
Because we voted money to cover, you couldn't carry it over anymore.
Right, so we took it out of school choice to pay. That's why it's in the actual column for FY16, but it wasn't budgeted in FY16. But it's the end of FY50. I don't know what the deficit is until after we're done.
Right. So the money that we're giving back to the town, $22,000 here, we could have used on it if we
No, knew. We're not giving any money back.
Isn't a budget balance here of FY16?
Okay, so if you go to page five, Bob.
Okay, hold on. Of 16, right?
In 16. If you go to page 5,
got it.
We spend everything but $5.36.
Oh, okay. I was looking at
that's a different
thing. Right.
Sorry.
And then if you look at the second page, that's the school choice detail. We didn't spend $16,620. We keep that.
Right.
Okay. And then if the next page, I believe, is the circuit breaker, and we expended all of that. Except for it says budget balance of $2,285, but that's an encumbered payroll. And then the revolving account is also ours.
Okay. I was just looking at the last page.
Yeah, but I want to go back to this.
Shouldn't those all add up to the 13?
Pardon?
Shouldn't those all add up to the 13?
No, because they're all different funds, Katie.
Okay.
What I gave you the detail on is only Fund 003, which is on page 6. So if you look at, page 6, see on the right-hand corner, it says $16,619.
Yeah.
And 51 cents, and then look on my first page, what does that say? 16,000, we didn't spend 16,620.
Yeah.
So it ties out.
Okay.
Yeah, and page 6 is just school choice, but the other pages beyond that are other accounts,
other
right?
funds yeah. that are our.
Okay. Circuit breaker being
so
one.
This is just the school choice.
Sped revolving right. is the other.
Yes,
account.
This is just school choice. And there is no more circuit breaker, it's gone.
We don't have any circuit breaker kids.
No. And that's a good thing.
So I still don't understand why this 3368 is coming out of school choice when we voted in our June meeting to cover the cafeteria expenses.
Because it came from FY15. At the end of June of FY15, we had a deficit in the lunch account of $3,368.14. I had to cut a check to the town to put that into the school lunch account. Remember the prior year we had to give like 15 grand to get the thing?
Yeah.
So this was FY15's deficit.
I think what I'm hearing is that in June you voted that whatever happens to this year's
16's money.
Yeah, I understand that, but I 15 should have been covered already. It shouldn't have been covered in 16.
I don't know what it is in 15, Bob, because I have to, I don't know in June
Don.
What the debt of Don. I don't know in 15 what it is to cut a check out of the money. So we use the school choice because it's the revolving fund.
Well, in the future, I'd rather see you use a guesstimate. And if we have any funds left over, we encumber that guesstimate so we can cover that and we don't end up robbing school choice.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Especially for paying for cafeteria.
Right.
Well, and that, I mean, we're going to talk about the cafeteria report, and that's a bigger conversation.
But there was no money left over in the other budget,
right.
So we really wouldn't have been able to.
Right. Okay. So I'll entertain a motion to pay this.
I second.
So moved.
Thank you.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Thank you. And as I said, that's an anomaly. Hope usually sends her bills right on time. Let's see if she dropped the ball. And I want to pick it up.
All right. So, you're done with your report, Patty?
I am.
Okay. Thank you. Unfinished business, Green Community Grant. Where are we with that?
So we are getting the contract ready. I have to get the contract from Brian Domina. He did send it to me, and I have to give it to Mr. Lesko so that he can have the contractor sign it, and then the work will start, and the order for the materials will begin.
Okay.
So it was accepted and approved by the school committee, I mean by the select board. Brian wants us to use a Whately contract, so he sent that to me, and with the prevailing wage, and I have to get that to the contractor to sign, which I will do first thing tomorrow, and get that all squared away. I received the email while I was on vacation, and I haven't had a chance to meet with Bob. We'll get that done this week, and orders and materials will be done.
Can you remind me what this project is?
The town of Whately got a grant through the Green Communities, because Whately is a green community, and we are putting in some energy management system upgrades to our current, so that we'll be more energy efficient.
Uh-huh.
And they set aside $130,000, and Mr. Lesko and I drew up a scope of work, and we put it out to bid, and it came back at about $73,000. So Mr. Skrowski, superintendent, Dr. Carey, myself, and Bob Lesko went to the town, and they now have authorized us to look to do another small lighting project to use the rest of the funds between the $130,000 and the $74,000 that this project came in with two alternatives. So we're moving on that too, because all of this has to be done by December 31st or we lose the funding.
So the first part, the first $74,000, where are we using it?
HVAC.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, building controls.
Okay.
Yep.
And then the other part could be, you said lighting?
We're gonna do a small lighting project.
Okay. But most of our lighting, correct me if I'm wrong.
I'm curious what that.
I don't, I'm Bob couldn't be here with us tonight.
Bob was talking about LED.
LED, but we're going to switch some of the lighting over to LED, which is more cost-efficient.
I know this has been changed a few times since I've been here. I know it's probably been changed, probably about the same amount, because it was original.
We're on like an S something, or I forget what they call this lighting.
I don't know.
Got a letter and a number.
I'm going to want to talk to Bob a little bit about this, because for a few years running, we were trying to do two classrooms at a time each summer, and changing over to lights that were more like natural light, because we have students for whom fluorescent lighting wasn't working. You know,
right.
They, you know, OTs were diagnosing kids needing, you know, overlays and things like that. People, even adults, sometimes struggle with that light. So we were moving to bulbs that were more natural lighting. I don't know how LED compares to that, and if that's going to undo anything we've done in terms of, you know, making as natural a light as we can. But
we have to stay within the restrictions of the grant as well. So
in terms of how we spend the money.
Exactly. Yeah.
But I'd like to do a little research on how LED lights affect.
It has to be done very quickly, because we got to move, because we got to get our second application.
I just don't want to spend more money after having spent money for years, you know, putting in nice natural lights, you know, natural full spectrum, that's what they're called, full spectrum.
Maybe it's, I'm not sure how much it's going to cost if we're talking classrooms or the gym. You know, LED maybe in the gym, maybe LED in the cafeteria.
Maybe LED outside the building.
You know, so we may not tackle the natural light that we've switched over, you know, to help everybody.
I'll talk to Bob and see if we can learn more. So it has to be an energy project.
That commits with the green communities.
But I do support definitely natural. The full spectrum
lights have helped a lot.
I don't even have the lights on in my office. So.
All right, I'll talk to Bob about that. Thank you.
Can I just ask a question? It's new this year. What's all this little dash? Must be something to do with the new superintendent.
It is. Thank you.
Did I have any idea? I just saw it. I said,
I have an evaluation that's about this thick. And so everything that I'm doing, I'm keeping track of for my evaluation.
Okay.
Marty did that last year, too.
These little doohickeys?
Absolutely. She did. So.
I don't. You just seen her for the first time.
Sorry.
It's because we put new lights in here.
It just took Bob a while to catch on.
Thanks a lot.
All right, so anything else on the community grant?
Nope, we'll keep you updated.
You don't have to vote anything, do we?
Okay. I'm assuming that when they bid on that, they did bid with prevailing wage?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Have to.
Because that would take it out of this world if they have.
Right.
Cafeteria report. I have no idea what you got in mind here.
I don't either, but what I pulled for you
here it is.
Was the end of the year financials and the participation statistics. So I think what we should do at this point is just, you know, have a conversation about why we're losing money. And why now our participation is back down. And we have, one of the things that is driving the loss is the fact that our school is small, so our meals per labor hour are always going to be higher than recommended by the industry standards, because we can't have less than two people serving lunch. It's physically impossible for one person to serve kids at lunch. One has to be at the register, one has to be serving the food. So because we are so small, our labor is always going to be higher than what the industries predict. But our revenue, if you look at this two-pager and go to the second page, and I'm just looking at the revenue at for student lunches, not a la carte and milk, we went down up this year 335 lunches, but our participation is down 5.68%.
Can you explain that? What does that mean? How can the two be different?
Because it seems to me, yeah, see, the numbers don't make sense, and that is what confuses me. So it's an aggregate. So if you could look at each month, we had 20, and maybe my numbers are wrong. 46, 30, yeah. No, that's, oh, here, you can have this.
Which number are you looking at, the last one?
Yeah, I think my numbers are off on that spreadsheet, Annie, that is why. Hang on a second, I'm sorry.
Right, because I noticed that the overall participation.
Well, it could be right, yes.
It says 14,133 relative to 13,798. So if that's for the whole year, then we should have a positive number. And month to month, most months we were down, but there was a few months when we were.
Right, I mean, look at June, we were down 621 lunches, so why are we up?
Yeah, June might also have been an anomaly this year because.
Of the number of days, absolutely, it's the number of days.
But, you know, generally speaking, I think we've had this conversation. I think part of the problem with all schools and all school lunches is, you know, parents don't want to spend a lot of money on their kids' lunch. They'd rather send a lunch than spend money. And if you're, you know, depending on your expenses in the kitchen, you can't make school lunches too expensive because people simply won't buy them. So I don't know what, that's the sheet that I don't know is, you know, all of our school lunch expenses relative to mm-hmm. how many meals we anticipate selling. I'm not the school lunch manager, but I would imagine that in a regular everyday business, you would say, okay, we need to sell this many meals this year to cover our expenses. I don't see that sheet ever, so I'm not sure how it works.
One of the reasons is we did, the reason that we have served more meals is because we had six more serving days in the school FY16 than we did in FY15. And I'm going to make the assumption that that's because we got rid of the half-day parent meetings and had them scheduled on the early release days, mm-hmm. so we had more serving days.
In which year?
This year, FY16. This past year.
We had more full days of school because
we were serving lunch on the early release days where we didn't release, when mm-hmm. we didn't serve lunch on parent conference days.
Who's our manager?
Deb Zimnowski.
Is that the last conversation I had that we're going to make some changes on that too?
Okay, so that would be a personnel matter which we cannot discuss in public meeting.
Okay, I'm just.
So the average daily participation, that number may be wrong, I guess, but how do you calculate that? Is that based on the total?
The average daily participation?
Like, is that of all the children?
We take the number of meals by the number of days in the month that we served, and then by the average enrollment.
So this is saying essentially 65% of the children ate school lunch.
Correct.
During the year.
Right.
Which is a good amount.
Which is good. Like, because
I mean, I guess I just the industry wonder what does standard it need to be.
Like, the industry standard is 70.
Right.
So our participation is good.
It's pretty high.
You can't
get 100%.
No. So we need to lower our, one of the things we can do is look at lowering our food costs. Now we do mm-hmm. go out to bid, but one of the thoughts, and again, this is part of a bigger conversation, and I have not had the time to acclimate Dr. Carey yet on all of the little anomalies in our programs, but one of my thoughts was that if all four elementary schools, I know we don't want to combine them, everybody wants to keep their own, but if all four elementary schools had the same menus, we could purchase better.
So you're saying maybe three out of the four would probably do that, but one wouldn't.
I'm not saying that, you know.
I mean, that's
possible.
Well, he knows, I'm just saying, I'm not picking on any particular school, but you're right. If we went on the same menu 5 days a week, and we know weeks ahead of time or months ahead of time, this is our schedule for today. If we get a snow day, then that meal, depends on if it's frozen or not, can be put off until we have another day or something like that. But I mean, that's.
Right. These numbers aren't making sense to me because we have one of the highest participation rates, yet we're losing $7,000. And I know part of it is the staffing.
Right.
So I can't attack the staffing. So I've got to attack the food costs.
Or the revenue.
We also discussed at the end of last year that if staffing were moved into the budget, all or part of it, then we would at least have, you know, we'd be taking a variable out of the lunch program. It would be a fixed cost in the budget, but we would, you know, we would.
So if we'd be
taking that out of the school lunch program, and then the numbers would certainly look.
So different. if we did that, the money that we bring in would just pay for what we're purchasing then, not. not salaries too.
Essentially, I would say that's correct.
Basically. I mean, it's up to you, Patty, because I wouldn't know, but be something if, no. What I'm saying is if the salaries for the manager and the lunch people is $50,000 a year, and we bring in $69,000 a year, and there's a difference of 19, does 19,000 pay for the food that we're purchasing?
Well, our food costs this year were about $22,000.
Okay.
$24,000.
And our revenue was?
$50,476.
So how does this compare to prior years?
I'm sorry. But that would pay for the food, plus if the salaries were part of the budget.
Our deficit is higher this year, Katie. So last year it was the 3368.
And then the year before you said it was 15,000?
Well, no. The law changed. So we were allowed to be in the negative in our lunch account.
So we had to absorb.
Oh, so you've been building up.
Up for a few years.
And then the law changed and said, no, the school committee has to make the fund whole.
So this is the biggest deficit we've had so far. So, I mean, the only thing I'm thinking is there some sort of pricing, like, I mean, I would pay up front for the whole year, honestly, not to have to pay every week or whatever. If there's some way to think about bringing in more revenue by kind of securing that money up
right.
front.
And what we've done is right now we've been experimenting with paying out of school time and prepaid tuition by credit card. And right now it seems to be successful, and we're hoping that other towns are going to allow us to do the same thing. We're working with Deerfield right now, and we've been working, and it's been working really well.
So they can pay online?
Yes, so they can pay online, and it's something we are going to hopefully go to the other three towns and say, we did a pilot last year with Deerfield, it's working really well. Would you allow us to take payments through your system that you've already created? Because all the towns take payments like real estate taxes and things like that through credit cards. So they just have to open another account. They have to a separate fund within that account for our monies to go through.
So do they pay the transaction fees, the town?
I believe it's built into the parents have to pay the transaction fees. Just like the citizens who want to pay their real estate taxes online have to pay a fee.
Okay.
Which is probably usually 1.5% or 2%, so.
But some parents find it's worth the convenience.
So I would be remiss if I didn't just comment that one of the problems, as you all know, I'll state the obvious, is that if we reduce food costs, we could be reducing quality of the lunches too, if we don't buy well. And that, to me, is a big issue. I don't want to see our lunches. Obviously, the state totally regulates what we have to do. But even now, I still find items that I don't think are a great lunch for kids. Mm-hmm. And it's probably, they're on the menu probably because they're really inexpensive.
Right. So what I would like to do is we do buy a lot of pre-frozen or frozen processed foods. And I want to work with the managers. And we have a great resource with the hire we did in Deerfield. He's a retired food service manager from Enfield, Connecticut at the high school. And he has really turned the Deerfield program around. And I'd like to work with him and the others with menu planning. Mm-hmm. And oddly enough, now his participation is down, but he has no deficit this year. So it just doesn't make sense.
That speaks to potentially the purchasing.
He did a better job purchasing than our other schools.
Are we purchasing from the same place?
We are, but it depends on what you're planning your menu. And that's why I'm saying
planning is pretty important.
If all four schools had the same menu, we could know what the food costs.
Yeah, I don't see a reason why we couldn't try and do that.
Right. I think there's also a difference if you're buying a lot of frozen pre-cooked food and you're not cooking from scratch, that things are less expensive if you're cooking from scratch. And, you know, if you're just putting little frozen blocks on a tray and...
So that gets how many people you have helping.
Yeah.
Right. So, but we might be able to do something like we prep it at Deerfield and they cook it here. So we do scratch cooking where they prep it at Deerfield, but then we bring it over here to bake it or put the finishing touches on it.
Mm-hmm. So So what kind of collaboration is there now between all the...
None.
Well, you know, well, there is, must be a little bit, because Deb's here, and she works at the high school.
That's what I was going to say. We hired a person to coordinate our menu and to make these changes, and I don't think we've seen that. In a general sense, we can. And, I mean, we have to.
I mean, we until the law changed, it's been a deficit as far as I can remember it. Do you remember a profitable year when you were a principal?
And the only time it ran...
Back when we had peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
No, back in the day when it was in the school budget, the salaries, then it was a no wash because you covered the salaries and you covered the food. Okay? And I don't think anything's going to change. I mean, I'd like to tighten it up. I think you could do that. But as far as running in the black, I don't know if that's ever possible, to be honest with you.
Those conversations, from my perspective, would be, and I know it wouldn't be, you know, the school committee's first choice or parents' first choice. If we were to go out and hire an outside company instead of doing everything in-house, we hire an outside vendor to run our food service program, I can tell you from my experience in other districts, they would shut down every kitchen and just cook out of Frontier and serve and cart hot lunches over here. And then I think parents and school committee would have issues with the quality and the temperature of the food on serving. I've done it, I've satellited it, and it's not always a pleasant experience. So knowing that that's not a direction that we want to go in, I would like to at least work with Dr. Carey with some ideas, and maybe what we do is we hire an outside consultant to come in and say, listen, this is what we have. How do we best do this?
That could be helpful.
If there's, you know, if there's any grant money around to bring in a consultant that, you know, it's, because we know they're not cheap.
Right.
You know, so I mean, hey, I'm all for... Hey, if it's 65% we got eating, but we're still in a deficit, and the biggest drive is thing, maybe this is the upcoming year when we start putting the budget together. I mean, we know there's other more important things that we could put in our budget, but maybe,
maybe
to help, if the town knew how much every single year we had to put into this, maybe we could put the salaries into our budget this the first time and try to keep them there. I mean... And that way we would run in the red instead of the black all the time. And maybe we could buy, with the extra money that we would have, maybe we could buy a few more little things that would drive it up to 70 or 75%. I don't know that. Maybe we should invite the senior citizens from town to come in and buy a three, I don't even know how much it is now. What's our meals, $3.25? $2.75. Okay, maybe the senior citizens would come
extra
in here and buy a half a dozen meals to help our... Well, $2.75 for a meal. If I worked in town all the time,
well, the adult meals are more.
Okay,
the
but still for four, yeah. Whatever it is, $4 or $5. I mean,
the only counter I'd like to offer for that is that I think it's valuable to have a profit and loss for the food for the cafeteria, just to understand the relationship between the revenues and the expenses.
And Desi still would require us to do that, no matter who's covering the budget.
So I might suggest that we just build in whatever, like a deficit, that we always know there's going to be some money charged to the budget at the end of the year, and that would be a way to cover that.
Right.
I mean, we can talk about how we do it, but that would be another way, rather than increasing the budget by all these expenses.
Or taking school choice money.
Right. So by budget time, I want to be able to look at all four elementary schools and try to get some understanding. Mm-hmm. Even I might even call our friends at DESE who came and did our program audit and say, explain to me why I have 65% participation. Right. And they're going to give me all these stats that your labor is over, that this is over. So then if I can't change my labor, how do I drive my costs down? So there's resources out there, and I want to avail ourselves of them. That is going to be something I'm working on before we go to budget season.
You know, is there government food?
We do. We buy. We got them out.
Are the other schools in the same position?
We're all over the place. Mm-hmm.
Conway's probably the best.
Conway's always at a dead break even.
Yep, always. something to talk about on another day.
Yep. Keep working on it.
Yeah, I think it would be helpful to get some more information on it.
All right. Summer building maintenance update, new business.
I think that's me.
Yeah.
And essentially, my entire principal's report is about that, so we could skip it when we get to the principal's report. But if you've had a chance to just look it over briefly, I put it in front of you.
Do you want us to just look at the principal's report and go through that with what you're going to talk about?
Yeah, and dispense of both of the items on the agenda.
Okay.
So if you just take a quick look at that front page of my principal's report, number one, I just wanted to give you the highlights. I think I covered most of what we did, and then, you know, at the very end, I added all the regular summer maintenance, all the floors that get stripped and waxed and things like that. But I tried to highlight for you some of the big things. We did have a busy summer here, first time, you know, in my tenure that we ever had summer programming in the building, and we had several classrooms filled for most of the summer. So that, you know, created some hardship for the custodial staff in terms of when they could do what. So in the end run, we have a couple of projects that aren't entirely finished, like that girls' bathroom right there that I showed you, but that will be done shortly. But despite that, I think we got an awful lot done. And a couple of the items on here are just for your edification. They weren't summer maintenance, like the gym padding, which is going in the next couple of days that it's going to be installed. That also is not a budget item, just so you know. That's money that there was some fundraising done by the recreation department in the past, and then last year town meeting appropriated the rest of that money, and this is the vendor who's going to come in and complete the work. So that's not school budget money, but obviously it's your gym, so I wanted you to know about it. But many of the other things on that list: playground mulch, repairing some broken windows, you know, maintenance in the kitchen, the hood vent needed a repair recently, and then some things that we never did before. I think all the stainless steel appliances in the kitchen, for example, well, most of them were pulled out from the walls and scrubbed down with, you know, Brillo or whatever you call it, some steel wool. They look beautiful, you know, but we really, these guys who we have on board now, really like to tackle some of the things that just have been neglected over the years. Lots of painting, as you can see, that first item or the second item on the list. We painted several classrooms, all three bathrooms, counselor's office, psychologist's office, kitchen manager's office, cafeteria storage room. What's not on there is that both of the custodial closets have been totally overhauled, sheetrock torn out that was old and moldy and wet, replaced. Both the slop sinks, I guess, the ones on the floor called slop sinks, both of those have been replaced in the past couple of years. New, Bob, what's that paint you put on your garage
epoxy
floor? Epoxy floors in both. So the building is, you know, shaping up. I mean, it's definitely getting rehabbed since, you know, the past couple of years with Mr. Skipton here as our custodian. Safety updates happened this summer too. Again, not all of this is our custodian's work. We had contractors come in and do things like pour concrete across the island, fix some broken concrete on our sidewalks. We had the tinting put on the windows for safety purposes. Those are all contractors. Playground mulch, etc.
I just want to add the walkway that we had put in through the island. That is also something that the town had wanted us to do for a long time, especially after we got the lighting over, when we put the lighting in over on that side of the parking lot. So it really complements, and people can feel safe now that they can park over there and have a nice safe pathway to the school.
Especially in the wintertime.
Especially in the wintertime. Yeah.
Many times.
So that was a good project.
But a lot of little things that for years went unfixed, like the vent. You know, when you turn our lights on in all of our bathrooms, the light and the vent goes on at the same time. But many of the motors on those vents had died, and you know, now they've all been replaced. Just tree maintenance around the campus. Not, that doesn't include all the trees that needed to be cut down because of the fire. Our town highway department took care of that. But long before the fire happened, Andy went around and, you know, made room behind the fence. If we ever have to evacuate the playground, one of our escape routes is to go through the fence and into the neighbor's yard. And with all the brambles and tree branches, you know, there has to be a passage through. So despite having programs here all summer, I think they did a really great job.
Some of the things I saw was really good. The bathroom that you showed me, I'm not sure if anybody else has seen this bathroom that's under construction, but
yeah,
I looked at the boys' room, and it looks really good, and the girls' room will look just as good, I think.
The boys' room years ago had some new dividers put in, and there's still a little tweaking in there. They weren't installed great, but all the other bathrooms now have all new dividers. Oh, the pre-K three bathrooms all got new paint down there too. So, I mean, we're really brushing up the building quite well over the past few years. Bought some new equipment too this summer, just minor things like a dehumidifier to help the rugs dry faster, and a staging platform, which again helped our custodians to get up, do the painting work that we needed to do. We're not done in here. You'll still see some water stains in here, but you won't see them anymore in the cafeteria. And also, we didn't want to paint the ceiling tiles and replace them until we've had a few good rains since last year when they put all the new screws in the roof. And so far, so good. Knock on wood, we don't have any leaks that we're aware of. So we went ahead and replaced tiles and painted, and we'll get in here and do the same.
Where did the tables come from out in the playground?
The tables were purchased by the out-of-school program a little over a year ago, I say, Patty. Maybe that's when they bought them. They, you know, they used out-of-school time money to buy them, and I think they did it for several of the schools, in part so that when the students were here after school, they had a place to sit outside.
And have snack if it's a nice day.
Yeah.
But those are really great, and they were so much fun to have this year for our kindergarten ice cream social. Mm. More people sat down with their families, kids sat around the tables, an umbrella to keep the sun off them. Yeah. Those are very nice, and those are great. I mean, they're solid, you know, metal covered in plastic, you know, what's that called, coated.
Yep.
So I think they'll last,
powder coated.
I think they'll last a long time.
Yep, good.
Is there any talk of keeping summer programs sort of distributed over the summer? Or? I've heard from other people that that worked nicely to have them, that Deerfield didn't have to bear the brunt of everything and just sort of dividing.
It was really nice having, you know, some teachers and kids in the building this year. I don't know that there's been any talk of it. We did it mostly because Deerfield was under construction, but you know, I would welcome a program or two here in the summers. You know,
there's a, couple of things that need to be worked out. For instance, if there's any children that need nursing and, you know, that kind of thing. And
better to have that in one space.
The cost per.
It's
a wonderful program. And you do a great job. Mm-hmm.
And while we're on maintenance, I just wanted to ask, and at our June meeting, we asked the administration to come up with a 3-5 year plan of maintenance to be presented in September. And this is September. Obviously, we don't have a plan. So I'm wondering where we are.
So we talked about that. We have been working on it. What I have asked Bob Lesko to do is provide a 5-year plan, working with the principals to come up with a 5-year plan for each and every building, and to be discussed hopefully at our November meeting, that we can talk about what we need for this building and put it in practice. You know, so that we're aware of the budget and what we need for each of the 5 upcoming years. But it's always best to have a 5-year vision, a 5-year plan for where we need to be going.
Well, that, you know, we talked about that in June, and I really, really feel the need. Because when we get, when something breaks and we don't know it's
broken,
in poor condition already,
right,
how do we fix it in the year we're in when we haven't planned for it?
Right.
And there are going to be things that'll break that you can't plan for it, but as much planning as we can, it's the only route to go, because the building's getting older. There are things that need to be replaced and done, and we need to know that.
It will help you, because you'll be able to take that plan to the town and make it part of the town's 5-year capital plan. It'll also help us in December when we're starting to talk about budget. Do we want to request a warrant article from the town? So it's not just, you know, where do we want to be, but how do we fund that? So maybe some year we would want to put a warrant article. We need to have that done already, because the warrant articles are due at the end of December.
When are the capital projects due?
That would be the end of December.
Mm-hmm. I just want to remind you that last year we submitted late a capital improvement item for redoing the phone system in this building.
For this year.
And when that comes through from the town, I hope it's submitted in a timely fashion, so it gets to the Capital Improvement Committee as a request.
So it doesn't roll over if we didn't get it
this
year?
It'll be there, but I think you need to include that reminder.
Need to go lobby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I just want to pull it back here for a minute, because I'm not quite done, but I want to do say this, that I'm happy to talk to Bob about a five-year plan, and I apologize in advance if he's, I don't remember him asking me to sit down and really talk about a 3 to 5 year plan, but I'm happy to do that, and I think that that my lead custodian now has a really good sense, after having been here for a while, of what we need to do. So I'm confident that we could come up with a really nice plan, a clear plan about what we need. But it's also a segue into number two here. We did talk about the phone system, and I know that's in the docket already, but I'm just reminding you, because we are back in a place right now where we have no active voicemail at our school, and I find that unacceptable. Last week we had a gentleman come in who took a look at our system, and I guess the next step is that, I think it was Hogan, does that sound right, who put our phone system in. I guess we need to get a master password from them, because I think the password's been changed over the years, and the gentleman who tried to repair this for us temporarily couldn't do the work because he doesn't have the master password. So I think that's where it stands. But hey, listen, don't quote me on that.
No.
How the phone system works. But right now we don't have voicemail, and that's a problem. And it's happened before, and in the past we've been able to clear mailboxes that were built up, and then we were fine. This particular time, I don't know why it hasn't worked. I know that Bob's in touch with it's Tom Antonellis, who came through and did what he could, and he's in touch with Bob, and hopefully we'll get it fixed, but that's still just a patch. So hopefully this phone system issue will go through, and I'll make my pitch again that we have this Bogan system on the walls of intercom, which is old and really doesn't work well. And if we do replace our phone system, I'd like it to be a phone system where classrooms have a phone that they can not only call the office with, so we don't have to use the Bogan system on the wall, that they can dial 911 with if they need to, and where they can receive voicemail and intercom system. Phone system. I have a safety measure in place right now where, you know, we have our walkie-talkies are on a different channel, and when they're in the cradle in the classroom, because God forbid if I had to call for a lockdown from the playground and can't get to an intercom, that's our backup system, you know. But if I was, you know, in the gym or in the art and music room and I could pick up any phone and call for a lockdown, that would be great. So whatever this new phone system is, I'd like to see it be a real comprehensive system. We also have clocks that are all running on, you know, some are plugged in, some are on batteries, also older. And I don't know if that's part of a phone system where you get all the clocks in sync and they sync up automatically, but you know, it would be nice to see that. And then lastly, I mentioned this before we started, is that I'm concerned about a lot of the carpets in the building. Some of them, we just can't get them to look clean. Most of them just don't smell good when they're, even after they've been extracted, cleaned, scrubbed, they just have mildew from years of use and kids' shoes and all that. When I mentioned it to Mr. Lesko, he said that if we were to pull rugs, we would probably not want to replace with carpets, that we would probably want to replace with tile in the future. That clearly would be a capital improvement project as well, so we need to keep that in mind if we want to do some large-scale replacing of carpets. It doesn't have to be all of them at once. I do understand that some of them were replaced a little more recently after the building was, you know, flooded at one point due to some leak, but that was before my time, so that means it's at least 7, 8, maybe 10 years ago. I don't know how long carpets last in a school.
Not as long as they can. They have a much shorter life cycle.
Yeah. Well, despite all the other nice improvements, the carpets are really not in great shape. So something to think about.
That would be great for the 5-year plan.
Yeah, something like that.
I was just asking Don. I didn't, you know, I forgot. But the schools pay for it. You know, if we're talking warrants, we also could talk about a bond for the school if we're going to do some major things. Couldn't we do a bond for the school if we're going to do some major projects like?
That's the town. We have no control over that. If we were to do a major repair project, depending on HVC or the roof or something like that, we could get MSBA funding. But if you're talking about just recarpeting the whole retiling the whole building, no, the MSBA wouldn't cover that. If we were talking about doing a window replacement and door replacements, or we wanted to put an addition onto the building, that could be something that we could go to MSBA, but it would still be the town's responsibility.
Right. Because, I realize that. I didn't know how much, if we decided to do them all one summer, whether we could or not tile all these, how much it would cost for
Right, but that would be on the capital project plan that we would submit, and we would also talk about what do you want to report, do we want to submit a warrant article like the, Mr. Skrzynski said, like this last year we did the phones, it was filed too late, so we want to put the phones, that seems to be the priority this year. So we absolutely should start making sure that the monies that we asked for on that warrant is going to cover the kind of system that Mr. Crisafulli is requesting.
Have we got an estimate yet or anything like that, or an idea?
Not a number that I can throw at you. I don't know. Bob may have a sense, but I don't.
It's hard, Bob, when you don't have funding to have someone come out and give you an estimate and then say, sorry, we don't have any money to do it.
Yeah. Is there a percentage of, like, best practice where I work is that you put aside 10% of your physical plant every year and you replace and renovate. Is there something built into our budget already?
No, we're not allowed to do that as a school because we are a part of the town.
So does the town do that?
Yes. I don't know. I can't say that. So
that's their deferred maintenance.
Right. We had in Deerfield and Sunderland, and I believe, no, I'm sorry, Deerfield and Conway, they have every year, they knew that the roof was coming. Mm-hmm. So every year the school committee would put a warrant article in to ask to fund a piece of that roof. So that when we went to do the roof project, we had the startup costs. Mm-hmm. Conway every year requests the town put $50,000 into the school repair fund. So they have a fund, yes. Mm-hmm. So in that vein, yes, we could start something like that,
request
Katie.
Request that a fund be set up.
Exactly.
To have
and then when
and
we
then
need,
plan for how we want to use it.
Exactly. So yes, we could mm-hmm. request the town to do that.
Mm-hmm. There was one last item, and then I'll be done with my principal's report. And it's not a maintenance item. It's just that I gave you all a copy of the letter that I sent to parents at the beginning of the year, my welcome back letter. It outlines the new folks that are in our building, so for your education, there it is. And it also talks a little bit about some of the things that we're planning to do in the social-emotional realm, you know, picking up where we left off last year. So that's just for you again to read over. And that's all I have for you.
I was interested to see the article in the paper
that was
reported
nice.
On some of this. How did that come about?
You know, Katie, I was wondering the same thing. It was it was the annual phone call where they just do the back-to-school issue.
Uh-huh.
And then I got a call from the reporter who, you know, I sent him an email about some of the things that I hope would just go into the back-to-school, you know, little
section,
square.
Yeah.
And he asked me more questions. I answered more of his questions. Uh-huh. Next thing I know, there was an article. He never said he was doing an article.
Uh-huh.
Sounds like he did it for the other schools as well in the recorder. I didn't see them the other... Maybe not the recorder. I think a couple of other schools had nice articles too, but I was very pleased to see it.
Mm-hmm. Has there been any discussion of the fire in the barn or sort of what the plans are? Any?
Well, that's next on
the
agenda.
It's on the agenda.
Okay, sorry.
And I'll defer
jumping
to my
to
colleagues
that.
On that.
Okay, you're all done with the summer maintenance?
And C, personnel update.
Mm-hmm.
We covered both.
Well, I essentially, but it's an important.
Yes.
He knocked off three items for us.
Pete,
thanks, Pete.
Yeah.
You got a data boy tonight.
Yeah. All right. I think we'll move on to discussing the tree damage. As everybody knows, we did have the barn fire out here and did destroy a number of trees out here on our property. We did meet with Len, myself, and Bob, was Bob there?
Patty and Bob.
And Patty and Bob. And, you know, we were, first of all, concerned about getting the trees down and who was going to do it and so forth. And ultimately, it ended up the town was going to take them down, and they did. They did mm-hmm. a great job. And Bass, too.
Yeah.
I guess, do you know what they're going to do with those logs?
The ones that are all stacked up, I think, need to be burned further. And someone mentioned that, you know, that's going to happen, dig a hole, throw them in, burn them up the rest of the way.
I got somebody that will take them. We got to it, I have somebody that will take them. But I don't know who we should talk to about taking
Keith?
Them.
Yeah, I don't know.
Keith Bardwell?
Keith or the select board? Or
I would.
Brian?
I would start with
Keith. You got to ask somebody. Is this
no, Keith said he was going to come to this meeting.
Yeah.
Remember we said that.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he's not here.
I'll touch base with Keith tomorrow and... If we have no home and it's going to cost the town more money, I have somebody that would take them.
Mm-hmm.
He has an outdoor. He has one of those outdoor boilers, and he burns pine, anything. And he said he would take them also.
Good.
So, I mean, but I'll double check with Keith. If Keith says, you got to check with the select board or check with you or check with somebody, then...
It won't be me. At this point, it's more at the town level, I think, and what's happening next.
But I'll check with Keith then tomorrow on that.
Okay.
Hey, have you noticed a need for a fence right now to keep the children, just for safety's sake?
No, not for that purpose, but I am very concerned about when, you know, first of all, I don't know when the time of year is when the fields are just dirt, and if it doesn't rain, this dirt's going to blow onto us. But before we get to that time of year, I think we're going to have wind pushing snow and making our road a little harder to keep clear. You know, if wind blows across that field, just like it does on Long Plain Road, on bad winter days, the wind just creates, you know, you're driving down the road and it's nice and clear, and then you got a big stretch that isn't, and I'm worried about that. And then certainly when, I don't know who owns those fields or what they spray, but it would be nice if we have some barrier when that time comes too.
Spring.
As far as kids going over there, our students are well supervised. We don't go to that area to begin with. The closest we get is the PE field, and they have an adult with them. They don't leave the field. You know, we don't have kids that are going to, you know, run over there and go explore, especially now that, you know, it's been cleaned up and stuff.
I mean, spraying aspect. I'm not that concerned with it at this point because spraying is done for the season now. Mm-hmm. And they usually don't do any spraying until late spring into the summer when the kids aren't here. Not to say that there isn't overspray, but we need to do something with a barrier.
Like arborvitaes or something, or hemlocks, or arborvitaes are a little easier to maintain than something that will be 50 feet.
At this point, I'm going to...
Keith had talked, he had an arborist come in, and when we met with the selectman, he had said something about, I don't know the name of the pine. Do you remember?
I don't.
Some kind of pine that's really thick. It's not like the, you know, the scrub pine you see, but...
Well, hemlock will keep branches lower, so it give you more of a barrier, you know. Mm-hmm. Instead of pine trees losing all its limbs down here, and it's bare looking out, at least the hemlock...
Well, didn't they also ask us, Mr. Skrowski, if we wanted, if we were interested in maybe getting some more land over that would be available for a parking lot?
That was another discussion, because what Sanderson's own essentially is what the barn and I guess a right of way. So essentially, that's of no value to them.
Right.
Well, you know, maybe they correct me, but I don't think so. It's all sand. You can't really grow anything on it. And there was some discussion about whether or not the town would be interested in purchasing that for a parking lot or extra space for a buffer. As you know, at town meetings, when we've got a real hot one going, you can't find a parking space. They're all on the road. So it's maybe a good idea. I'm thinking possibly it would be worth exploring what they want for it. First of all,
so I think the town was asking asking the school committee, is this something you would like to consider, and giving an answer. But is it? I guess my confusion is it would the parking lot alleviate the need of us to put the physical tree barrier up there, or is it two separate issues?
Two separate issues.
Okay, so we definitely want the trees put back up.
I think what you have to decide, at least the way I look at it. You have to decide if you were to purchase that land, because it's going to determine where you're going to put your trees.
Okay.
If you purchase it, and even if you don't put a parking lot in, you still want to put the trees at the very end.
Right.
So it creates
a parking lot.
Closer to the property.
Well, maybe for this winter, if we have some snow fence, we can go from there to there, and we could put up a 3 or 4 foot snow fence.
Right.
What's
that
with
school fence? You're in his personal space.
You're in my, are you turning down the theory?
That was the reason for my question, Mr. Christopher. Was for right now, do we need a snow fence? Do we need a barrier for the children? We also talked about putting up a fence and having, you know, just putting low bushes there, you know, for time. The other question is, are they taking out the stumps, or are they going to plant in between the stumps? This is the kind of thing. If we buy it, if the town buys it and we make a parking lot, then they would clear out the stumps.
Is this part of the capital plan? I mean, is this something we have to decide immediately?
I don't think it's something you got to decide immediately, but I think.
We need to talk about.
We as a school committee can't go out and say we want to, we're going to purchase this land.
Right.
We have no authority.
Right.
It has to come from the selectmen and it has to go to the town.
We can probably think about a fence, like a plastic, you know, like a vinyl barricade fence for the wind and the, you know.
And I believe this is, whatever we do is going to be covered by their insurance policy. Replacing the trees, putting up a temporary barrier will all be covered by insurance.
By the town's insurance?
Yes. And then the town will fight it out with the owners. I think they're just asking the school committee, what direction is it you want us to take? Because we've got to tell the insurance company how large the plant's going to be. Now, I don't think they're going to be planting 12-foot trees, so while those things are growing, what do we want in the meantime?
Well, we don't, some sort of, just speaking as your building manager, if you will, I think some sort of a barrier would make me feel more comfortable for the reasons I cited before, whether it's dirt that might blow here when the spring rolls around, whether it's the wind pushing snow onto the road that we just had plowed by the town that morning and then has to be done again, and creates a hazard, or down the road other things, and I'm not sure. I like the idea of a barrier of some kind. I think that the idea of expanding the parking lot would be a once, twice, maybe three times a year benefit when you have town meeting, when we have pancake breakfast, you know, when we have spaghetti supper, so that folks don't have to walk in
graduation
house from the road, right?
Concert.
There's a few nights, maybe more than three or four, but that would be nice to have a little extra parking. The parking lot pretty much is full here. If you pull in during a school day, you'll probably find one or two spots. Mm-hmm. People overflow park across the island, and they do that on the grass. So one of the benefits of thinking about, obviously that would require the town to purchase the land. So I know that this committee doesn't have the authority to say so, but maybe they have the ability to make a recommendation. So I think if the town were to purchase the land, I think that would benefit the school. We could then decide to add a little more parking back there. If we're going to pour asphalt, I still would recommend that we pour it across the island on the other side too, where people already naturally.
Well, how much of that is leach field out there, though?
Yeah, we know where that is, and I think it's well beyond where that where people park now. But we can confirm that with the gentleman who takes care of our septic system. You know, I think he'd have a pretty good. Our plans tell us exactly where it is.
I was going to say, I hope you have plans.
Yeah, the plans would tell us exactly.
We're not where that old in this building that we
wouldn't have. Yeah, we can look at the plans. But I do want to say this: across the island, just like I couldn't get people to stop crossing the island when it was snowy and icy, I'm not going to get people to stop parking over there. So if we poured a little asphalt on the other side of the island, that wouldn't be a bad thing. And if
but
we expanded
when
the parking
you park
lot
over
slightly,
there, are
that
you
would
supposed
help
to be
too.
Parking parallel or?
Well, see, there's a problem. There's no
whoever
asphalt.
Gets there first decides
no,
what
right.
it's going to be.
Whoever's the first one asphalt, there. With no asphalt and no painted lines, people do what they want.
I think.
Ideally, the circle would work in one direction, and people could pull in on an angle and back out like you do, and then proceed. But that would require some asphalt and painted lines, and if we're going to bring an asphalt truck in, it would be nice if we could expand the parking lot if we owned it. And all those, I don't know how you're going to replant trees or even make the land useful if you don't have all the stumps pulled. So I'm assuming that all that's going to happen too.
So right now, for our immediate needs. We need a snow fence.
A
right
snow
now,
fence for sure.
For our
I would
immediate
say.
Needs.
I would say that would be a help.
Great.
Yes. What's that going to do?
Well,
stop the snow.
It might stop some of the drift.
We get a lot of snowstorms from the south.
Probably not many.
Then the wind blow
can
across that.
Can I make a suggestion? Since Mr. Bardwell didn't make the meeting tonight, could we possibly set up a meeting with the superintendent and Mr. Skrosky and myself to discuss what Mr. Bardwell, what his ideas are, as well as what the school committee's intentions may be, so that we could get, you know, a little bit closer to having a plan?
or go to the next select board's meeting and
I think they're expecting us to come back with a request.
12:30 tomorrow.
I mean, my opinion is if the Sandersons own it and you know, they may be nice, they may say, hey, it's not doing us anything, we'll give it to the town. But if we come across being, well, we're going to fight it out with our insurance company, with their insurance company, I don't think we're going to get anything for free.
But I'm just saying.
We're not fighting with, yeah, no, our town insurance is covering us. Okay.
But we,
our property.
Okay. I mean, hey, we can just figure out how much a fence is going to, we can get a fence. Here's a fence out here. How many feet do we need? We'll put a black fence with some bushes in front.
That's the original thing, and then that would cover up the stumps.
Yeah.
But then they wouldn't have access. But it would, a nice brown or something vinyl fence, right, that would block any dust or snow or pesticides.
I mean, I think this fence, on a big storm, it'll build up eventually against the fence. And wouldn't you think, Pete?
I mean, you mean like just
I mean, I, fence? I mean, this is, well, I think, yeah, this is less expensive than putting something really beautiful on this corner. I'm not an architectural planner.
So.
I can take those pine boards, we can cut them up, we can build a fence out there.
I'm not worried about the fence. I'm worried about overspray when agriculture is in progress.
Yeah. And the arborists say that the best thing
is a natural barrier around this building completely.
It's the intention.
The exterior of the building.
The original reason.
Right. Yeah.
Right, so just for that, and I heard you say that before, Don, that when this was developed and designed,
that was a major concern among parents.
Now we don't have that.
You know, there'd be overspray and carry over into the playground and into the school. And I think that's the issue we should be more concerned about than snow. Okay, look at last winter, did we worry about any snow?
No.
Farmer's Almanac said, though, this winter,
we're going to have snow.
But I think that what really needs to be decided is whether or not we move forward and see if we're going to purchase that, then figure out what we're going to do with the trees or put up whatever kind of barrier. And it doesn't have to be we're going to move forward next summer and build a parking lot. You can purchase the land or whatever, get it given to you. You got your barrier up and then you can move forward in the future. You know, so you don't have to rush to that, you don't have to worry about the stumps if you purchase that, because your barrier will be further back. You don't have to deal with those right away. So I think Patty's right. We have to put the heads together and figure out a plan.
So maybe tomorrow at 12:30 we could meet, check your schedule.
I think we should check Mr. Bardwell.
Yeah, we have to check
him. He's going to be the one that's hard to nail down.
And he may be,
thought we were going to meet first and then bring it to him. It's up to you.
Well, he's got the information from the arborist, so it would be nice to have that information before we made a decision.
Yeah, I think he should be there.
All right, then we'll get an appointment.
But I mean, how do you guys feel about?
I think it makes sense if there's an opportunity to get the land and the town is willing to consider it, to get that piece decided. And then, like you said, we don't have to act on the parking lot, but we can at least build the barrier in the right place.
I agree. Great.
We're ready.
Okay, so we're having the Massachusetts Association of School Committees joint conference in, I believe it's Hyannis, and it is November 2 to 5. If any member of the school committee is planning to attend, make sure you, Donna knows, and she's providing everything for you, and if you would like to be a delegate, go to the delegate assembly. The committee will need to vote on that person as the official delegate from this school district. Is anyone going to?
Do you want to go?
I know.
Do you want to go?
No.
I don't either.
Okay.
I've been once.
Great. So.
No, it's good. If somebody wanted to go, that's good. I can't get those kind of days off. I'm
tired.
My mother tired being taken off, so.
Mr. Chair, before we move on to reports, I wanted to make a comment in my financial report, and I kind of got a little swayed, so with your permission, I'd like to make that comment now.
You can make a comment.
Thank you.
If I don't like it, I'll let you know.
No. Firstly, I want to publicly apologize to Dr. Carey from our joint meeting regarding the central office move to Frontier, because I made a comment, and my comment was meant to be, in the best of worlds, I would have a year to budget this. But that didn't mean that I didn't have a budget plan. We just didn't have the budget plan ready until we knew what the Frontier School Committee was going to vote. So we do have a plan, and we do have a plan on how to fund that, which will be presented at the school committee, Frontier School Committee, tomorrow evening. So we've gone back and we've massaged some numbers. But I did want to publicly apologize to Dr. Carey, because it did seem, by some of the questions, that it seemed like she was unprepared, which was not the truth. And I think I misspoke, and I just wanted to clear that up publicly, that there is a plan, there is a budget plan, but we weren't putting the details on it until we knew what direction the committee wanted to head.
Make another comment on the fire. I wanted to say one thing. I just wanted to thank the fire department publicly, because from all the reports that I've heard, they did a great job keeping the school from having any damage other than the trees.
Well, I think that it was a godsend that we had a metal roof, because they were saying that
the embers were
coming down on that roof.
Plus it rained. What?
And then Bob, look at the roof.
Yes.
Not yet.
Oh, he didn't?
Well, no, I don't know that anybody's gone up there and checked it out. Unless it happened without my knowledge. I don't think anybody's inspected it that I'm aware of.
Yeah, I thought he was going to do that ASAP.
But it also rained that night too, which someone told me from the fire department, that which helped those pine trees could have been exploding.
If somebody
pine trees.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for the rain.
Yeah.
Please let me know if somebody has inspected the roof, but I don't know that it's been
done. But a lot of the fire department are parents also, and I think the kids have been talking about it.
And Katie, thank you for bringing that up. And also, you know, Conway, Deerfield, Sunderland, Amherst, we had a lot of respondents. So all the towns out there who responded, very grateful.
And with all the problems we've had with this roof, isn't it ironic that it's what saved
served
the day?
Us well.
And I think the oak tree on the corner will be fine once it goes through a season and stuff.
We'll keep an eye on it and make sure that we don't get up any damage and falling branches this year. But yeah, we're gonna keep an eye on it.
I think it got saved.
Reports
there, buddy.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Well, you've done yours, Pete. How about our superintendent? Do you have anything for us?
I handed out a superintendent's report.
Oh, thank you.
Do you have one? Okay. So the, I'm not even sure if this is grammatically perfect, but it was a wonderfully smooth opening district-wide. I was thrilled. I just was thrilled. This staff, these faculty members, these staff, these just the most enthusiastic group of people, the students. I'm walking around, went to every school today except Frontier, and what amazed me was you don't even know, the kids have only been in 3 days. They're so right into the swing of things. The teaching is phenomenal. I just was looking at our assessments, we have two wonderful, immensely skilled curriculum people, and I'm just thrilled. Curriculum's my first love, and I just am thrilled at what we're doing, what we're teaching. So anyway, it went really well, and I'm pleased about everything. I'm very happy to be here. So the enrollment for Whately, and I'm not sure if you all received this. So compared to last year, we're down 5 students overall. And when we look at the cohort of our first and second grade last year, they had 18 students each. And then this year, the second, third grade, moving up the cohort, they have 16 students each. Last year, the K-6 was 125. This year, it's 117. However, our pre-K has 3 more students this year than we did last year. So it's down 5, but the numbers kind of shifted a little bit. And overall, that's not bad. I think that's pretty good. I've been busy completing my interviews, my data gathering. I've met with so many stakeholders. I have a pile. I've put all that information together. Essentially, everybody just loves and is very invested in this school district from every single town. And I will put all that information together and for the joint committee in October and present my entry plan. I also am looking at the reports that were done, the audits that we had last year that were done, and that's providing me with a lot of information as well. My administrative team is tremendous, world class, best in the world, and it's just a wonderful place to be. Again, the Association of School Committees is meeting on KCAL. I believe it's Hyannis in November. Last chance, if you want to go. So the big thing for me, I was really fortunate when I came here. We have, this district is really, you know, getting into things. They've started with ASAP, which is a substitute kind of calling. If a teacher's going to be absent, if the substitutes can go right on the computer, they can pick the job, the teachers can be absent, they can upload their lesson plans right on this computer program. So we have that. We're in our second or third year. We're not starting our third year with it. We also have my learning plan. I don't know how many years we've been doing that. And that is our evaluation system, but it also helps teachers keep track of all the professional development they've done for their 3-year cycle of renewal for their license. These are all programs I'm familiar with. And so I was thrilled when I came here because we're all using, you know, I'm used to everything we're using. Well, one of the things that last year they were using Rediker, and they have been using Rediker right along as a school database. And we have transferred over to PowerSchool. And I have been using PowerSchool for over 10 years, and it's wonderful. And many, many, many districts all over the country use PowerSchool. So we really made the right move. And I think Paul Scott has done a tremendous job in getting us going on that. There's still some rough patches. I do know, I can tell you in Conway today, every teacher did their own class attendance. But it's slow. You go slow to go fast. There's still some things to work out. But in the end, we will find out how much easier PowerSchool is for doing state recording, for doing reports, communicating with parents. There's a parent portal for the older grades. There's gradebook for the teachers to use when they're developing their assessments, their grades, and transferring that onto a report card. The interface for the nurses, SNAP is there, and it's just a wonderful program that helps us to streamline all the kinds of information we keep on children and staff. And so you can see that the accounts and passwords are there. The state reporting is there. They've completed training with the admin staff. Some select staff, those are the people that do record keeping with our numbers. And then the high school teachers are using Gradebook already. And there's a portal for the parents. And they're functional, they're 100% functional. School Messenger service, I can use the program if I would like to send out a message saying, you know, good evening, this is Dr. Carey, just to let you know we have a wonderful district. And that recording can go out either through email to every home or through voicemail. And it'll try each home, you know, like a parent has a home phone, a landline, and a cell phone, and another one, but it'll keep trying until it gets one. And not an answering machine. And so the nurse program is, they're using SNAP. That was a lot of work. Power School sync data with School Messenger, that's, I can speak, Blackboard services, and that is when Blackboard is it's kind of like a technology classroom. And but the ongoing and future work for IT is the Follett Destiny Library Management System, and I'm very familiar with this, and they're syncing that to PowerSchool as well. So we're doing great stuff in the IT department, and I really felt like you needed to know how hard these folks worked this summer, taking one program, and then for some reason I think in the middle of July they just closed us down in Redeker. And we had to kind of say, well, give us at least two or three more days. We're not ready.
They were playing hardball because we weren't renewing the contract.
Exactly. So I need to tell you that
our transition.
Yes. Our IT department is wonderful. Our admin assistants are working really hard, adjusting to it. And the teachers, and again, it's intuitive, the program, but it's easier for some than others. Mm-hmm. So I think that with patience and appreciation, I'm thrilled.
So is there any communication going out to the parents about this? Or I guess I'm curious what the parents' interaction will be with the system? Because I did notice like the information that came out was kind of mixed up. So it seems like whatever they printed out, it's from the new system, and that's fine. Like, the numbers were just kind of mixed up, and I just corrected it.
What are you referring to, Katie?
The parent information sheet, the family information sheet that came out, had, like, my numbers in the wrong categories. So it would explain it to me if there was a system change, and that probably they just haven't mapped them quite right.
Yeah, that's exactly right. We encountered some field issues, right? Where when the two programs spoke to each other, some of the fields didn't match up well, or some fields had, you know, language in them and were covering numbers, but
so it just might be helpful for parents to know that there was a system change going on in the background, and that this isn't like, you've lost my information.
The goal is to, just to add to that, the goal is each year, you know, parents sign, you know, all this information.
Could we log in and just say it all looks fine?
So PowerSchool, you could do it one or two ways, but PowerSchool, can print out your information, so next year on the first day of school, all you have to go through is
correct. That's what they do now,
right?
Yeah. I think kind of in the wrong places, so right, they have to fix it, which is fine.
I think what Katie's referring to is that the initial transfer of information, yes, all the fields from Redeker and PowerSchool didn't necessarily
line up exactly. Yeah.
So parent one, you know, their cell phone number ended up maybe under parent two, and
right,
you know, some
it was,
things.
It was just not wrong
but
information,
it's all stuff
it was just
can,
in the wrong place.
I think that was just the initial communication from one program
and
to the other.
Maybe what we can do is send out one of those new messages and say, please check your things carefully, because we did have a data transition.
Mm-hmm. And right, I guess that's what I'm trying to say, so they don't think that, like, something was done.
I know, and I talk, you know, I love PowerSchool, and I think I do have access to PowerSchool, but I'm not sure. I have all these infinite visions, so all of these, I'm familiar with BudgetSense, but I'm having trouble getting it onto my computer, and, but yeah, I could probably look into doing something on School Messenger. So thank
you. I just think parents want to have confidence, like, that the data is correct. Mm-hmm.
Like to write an emergency number.
Right. They know they're going to be able to get contact.
Yeah, right. Well, I can tell you from my perspective, too, when I'm dialing parent number two's cell phone number, I don't
want to
call
parent
number one. I want to call parent number two.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Probably good.
The right thing.
Katie, did you want to look at it or sign the warrants?
Thank you.
Anybody have anything else? I just want to say, I didn't say it during the maintenance discussion, but our guys did a really terrific job. And, I mean, the building was terrific.
I couldn't believe it. I came on Sunday, the day of the fire, the morning after the fire, and who was the custodian?
Andy.
I keep wanting to say Al. Andy. He spent 2 hours with me, and we went over every square inch of this building. I am so impressed. So impressed. And his work ethic.
Yeah.
Did Donna call you? Because I text Donna.
Yes, yeah.
Donna must have texted you, so if I didn't have your number.
And I got right in the car and I said.
Because I was working down the road and I'm coming down the road and I said, you know, this is. And Bob Smith says, hey, did you hear what happened? I said, well, you know, I had some funny feeling when I went by the school. I said, yeah, the barn burnt. I said, what? So when I got done painting at Bob's house, which is just down the road, I pulled in. I said, wow.
Yeah, it was quite a thing. And they cleaned it up nicely. I mean, there's still that debris there, but
you know what? How many times have I been here? I never noticed it till now that it's gone.
Yeah, it's so beautiful now.
And you know, you talk about spraying, snowfall. You know, that barn was a big thing that stopped a lot. I don't know if the pine trees did much of it, but that barn was a big barrier right there.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it blew around the corners and stuff, but.
I wouldn't mind seeing a small greenhouse go in so we could garden year round with our students. Grow starts in the winter, be indoors. Very popular.
Blow up paper, seed untied, Pete, okay?
What'd you say, Don?
What did he say? I missed it.
I'll let him repeat it if he wants, right?
I'll entertain
him. I'll make a motion adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good night, everybody.
Come home and have some spaghetti.
Thank you.